This is Babette Babich, and this is a reprise on the same day. Today is the 12th of December, 2020. And I gave this little talk, this brief abbreviation of a longer text that will appear in Existence, a forthcoming issue. And this was a meeting of the Karl Jaspers Society that should have met, that would have met with the Pacific Division meeting of the APA in San Francisco, had it taken place, and that would have been in April. But it was delayed, and it was delayed until today. The other speakers were Dirk Johnson, who spoke on the Antichrist, Rolando Perez, who spoke on Jaspers and Unamuno, and Martina Prange, who talked about her forthcoming book, as well as some interesting reflections on Jaspers' Nietzsche interpretation. My talk was very, very long. The lecture title that was announced was even longer, but you can see this behind me, Jaspers and MacIntyre and Newman and Nietzsche's Acroamatic and Snape. So that's, you can see him, right? But I'm going to share a slide and you'll be able to see him sort of even more. That's the original version. STEM was crucial to this and the idea of the university. And I pretty much talk, odd sound, just about what I say I'm talking about there. So one of the things that I'd like to think about, here is the title slide for the talk itself with its actual title. I'm in Winchester, but I, of course, my appointment is at Fordham University in New York City. And one of the things that we, I think I have another slide. Yes, here now is a kind of a double effect if one likes. Also the focus on the Jaspers Society and the title again. And Snape, what is this? Why am I doing this? So I have an epigraph. All great philosophers are our educators. And that comes from Jaspers, Nietzsche, and Jaspers is obviously repeating Nietzsche with reference to Schopenhauer. The first section, there are four, on masks, education, and Severus Snape. During the 2020 coronavirus pandemic, in a move executed using numerous numbing Zoom discussions, but without debate, very important point, a decision was made to put everything or almost everything online, or else in a hybrid or bastard mode to teach in person, impersonally, that is, lacking the face-to-face. Thus, teachers from preschool to university now teach behind a mask, just as Socrates covered his head, I think I have that here, in his first speech on Eros. I hope I have a slide on Eros. Yes, I do. In the Phaedrus. So Platonists have told us, they've explained how this is really all about that. That's why this person is looking down bashfully at Heidegger, the idea of the mask itself. A number of individuals have gone over this most beautifully, I think, Adama, is that Socrates is ashamed of his own desire. And the whole point is that he might, that's what Platonists tell us, lie more easily, not say what he really feels. And as Nietzsche says, a human being must learn very much in order to lie. At stake is the abolition of teaching and learning. I make the case for the fictional figure of Severus Snape, named for the follower of a saint, celebrated for his ability to summon the dead for testimony. A character conceived by J.K. Rowling and portrayed by the late British actor Alan Rickman, 1946 to 2016, Snape represents everything counterindicated by today's educational assessments and teaching evaluations, so-called best practices, according to whom, as assessed by whom, for the sake of whom, criteria now championing distance learning, a mode of learning maligned, if I remember, for years, and often unregulated or else following self-arrogated rules, qua unaccredited, so-called correspondence learning online learning. Section 2. Jaspers' Nietzsche education on the idea of the university. Karl Jaspers composes his 1935 study of Nietzsche, arguably to educate a reading of Nietzsche in the context of National Socialism, where Heidegger is accused infamously, famously, of seeking to lead Hitler himself, den Führer führen, as is typically said, and typically said in German. It's important to note that this is Jaspers' phrase. Jaspers himself, for his part, continued a professorial tradition that goes back to Wilhelm von Humboldt. We see him here, echoing no less. He's celebrated for the solitude, Einsamkeit, and freedom of the university. You should be able to have both. A point that Jaspers is drawing from this, but which also, same point, echoes in Nietzsche's lectures, questioning the future of what he calls unsere Bildungsanstalten, our educational institutions, addressed to educating political movements to the extent that war and crisis practically occasion reflection on the university. In his Weg der Artsrede, Heidegger argues for a reset, strange word, one could suggest, I'm just mishing it up, of the university. And the idea of the service should be to some other goal. And we're doing something similar, serving health, I suppose. And that seems to be, Heidegger seems to be in apparent dialogue with some of Jaspers. 1923, die Idee der Universität, the idea of the university. For his part, Jaspers, directly or indirectly, accidentally, it doesn't matter, echoes John Cardinal, one could say, Henry Newman's 1852, the idea of the university. Continuing this tradition, Alastair MacIntyre's 2009, the very idea of the university, revisits a question prototypically debated and just as prototypically neglected as a question. So this is actually MacIntyre's concern alone. I am adding these bookends, Nietzsche and Jaspers. And I have another section on God and classics and Nietzsche and STEM. Writing as he does on Newman and the university, MacIntyre argues that theistic issues are decisive when it comes to secular institutions, which same institutions fail to comprehend those issues, and Newman's critics are affronted by what seems a contradiction. For MacIntyre, this is the quote, Newman was well aware that belief that God exists is contestable and that there are no knockdown arguments, especially compelling to every intelligent person, for the existence of God. After all, this is all post-Kant. MacIntyre, who is a specialist in incommensurable kinds, unpacks the problem at issue with deliberate care. He says, it is characteristic of contemporary unbelievers to believe that only if they were offered some knockdown argument whereby belief in God would be incontestable, would they be rationally entitled to believe that God exists? To which the theist has to respond that any being whose existence was thus justified would not be God. The issue is subtle. It's part of the reason Heidegger emphasizes the whatness of being, and it is a Scotist point. No science, qua science, as MacIntyre observes, citing Avicenna, proves the existence of its subject is true. Thus, MacIntyre argues, it would have been, notice the formulation, Newman's view that the fragmentation of our curriculum is a condition that needs to be remedied and that only an acknowledgement of theology as the key unifying discipline can adequately remedy it. It's a strong claim. And it's because no discipline today could be accorded the place. Notice this is very important. It's not science. Science can't do this. No discipline today could be accorded the place that theology has in Newman's scheme, but also because the claim that the knowledge of God is at once contestable and yet genuine and indispensable secular knowledge is at odds with the present-day secular university's understanding of the secular. By contrast with MacIntyre's theology, Nietzsche focuses on philology and thereby the Acroamatic in his 1872 lectures on our, by which he means the German, and the Swiss German educational institutions. In this account, Nietzsche included Gymnasium. He had to teach there himself, but also because only students prepared by studies at the classical Gymnasium would qualify for admission to the university. MacIntyre emphasizes that the idea of a university disintegrates without theology, lacking deity, while for Nietzsche, lacking hermeneutic and monumental philology, there is no educational institution. This Mangel an Philologie, to use Nietzsche's word in Jenseits von Gut und Böse, that section 47, is fatal. As he writes, for take away only the Greek, along with philosophy and art, on what ladder could you still wish to ascend toward education? Here's a sky ladder and gives you a kind of sense of what might be involved. Nietzsche's talking philology, not philosophy, and he notes that the problem with philosophy is that many who call themselves philosophers are not philosophers. They do what they do, not for the love of wisdom, but because they're compensated. It's a gig. If you pay for them, they'll write for you, they'll talk for you, etc. To the same degree, Nietzsche's overall problem corresponds to what we call STEM. That's really what Nietzsche was challenging already then. Thus, Nietzsche reflects on the conversion of institutions of culture that'll be Bildung, the older ideal of the university classically conceived, into newly applied institutions for the necessities of life. And later he's going to be talking about an Erzieher for the same purpose, eliminating the practically useless quite for the sake of useful specializations. And he thinks that that's not Bildung and that's not what education is for. We have a final and a fourth section, the Acroamatic and the philosopher. The word Acroamatic refers to the esoteric word of mouth, heard from an expert, sometimes epitomized as a word to the wise. One has to be able to hear it. It's very complicated. I try to explain it a little more in the longer version. So far, so good, though. As if, because what's this about remuneration? What am I doing? What is Nietzsche doing? Why is he saying these things? Good question, one. Try to pursue it. Nietzsche steals his test, filches it, for a true philosopher from Lucian. And, of course, in Max Weber, and Tracy asked a question about that, but in the longer version I cite Max Weber's Wissenschaft als Beruf, where he himself also draws on similar constellation. And Nietzsche takes that and kind of transposes it, almost word for word, to his Schopenhauer as educator. This is Lucian. You can check him out. And the text he's stealing from is Philosophies for Sale, right? The noblest of philosophies. I stole this myself on the internet for sale. The most distinguished fool to buy, who wants to be more than man. We recognize that phrase. Who wants to apprehend the music of the spheres and be born again. Great stuff. What does Nietzsche do? Nietzsche says, let the philosophers, pretty much from the same text, grow untended, deny them all prospect of place and position within the bourgeois professions. Cease to entice them with salaries, more, persecute them, show them disfavor. You'll behold miracles. No one will be trying to call themselves philosopher, is his point. Suddenly, it'll be empty. Everyone will have flown the nest, for it's easy to get rid of bad philosophers. One has only to cease rewarding them. And of course, it's significant because Schopenhauer is one of those independent philosophers. He wasn't paid for the classes he gave unless students registered for them, and he chose the time when he could be guaranteed to have no subscribers. Jaspers quotes Goethe on the venality, same point, also from Lucian, of professional research by contrast with independent scholarship, and that's independent science, and Goethe himself was such an independent science, and he's cited in Jaspers. Those professionally concerned with it aren't, Goethe says, really interested in it at all, but are merely interested in money and personal power. It's a strong indictment, and it still retains some purchase, I believe. And reminding us in his Nietzsche book, this is Jaspers Nietzsche book, that all, this was the epigraph that I began with, great philosophers are our educators. Jaspers argues in his The idea, this is an earlier text, of the university, that what tends to dominate in the university is mediocrity overall. He says the very translation of thought into teachable form tends, this is the danger here, to impoverish its intellectual vitality. On an existential level, the student's level, Jaspers foregrounds inevitable disappointment. One's expectations, he explains, this is with regard to the student, are only seldom fulfilled at university. The first rush of enthusiasm does not last. And that's, of course, something you can experience in almost every philosophy class from the beginning of the semester onward. Thus, Jaspers highlights the student's encounter with the person of the professor. It's to illustrate that person, that notion, that I bring in Rickman's personification of Professor Snape. And I do this with a kind of guilty conscience, because to this day, Potterheads, especially in philosophy, condemn Snape, this guy, as a teacher. They're not fond of him. It is as exemplar, I've written actually several articles on this exemplarity, that Snape reminds his students that there is a level of rigor of study, of learning, of discipline, quite apart from magical thinking. Thus his prohibition on wand waving and incantations. Snape himself, expert he was in both esoteric forms, wand waving and incantations, reminds his charges of the value of evidence-based magic, as it were. That would be potions that work and do so with or without one's faith in the matter. You don't have to control your emotions or your mind if you're using herbs and the like, potions. The exemplar, Carr, very important point about this means, corresponds to the Nietzschean language, exemplifying Jasper's attention to exemplarity. Snape's lectures, and this will be a fairly important point here, and utterances, they're the ones we remember, down to the last word in passing in a hallway or consultation, speaking with the student one-on-one, the above speech, which everyone knows, on wand waving, or warning, people will think you're up to something, or snarling, don't lie to me. And finally, training Harry to discipline his emotions, control his mind, and so on, all of that. The parallel with Snape underscores the relationship Jaspers invokes between student and professor, and that's going to be really important in this concluding section, which is almost concluded, the dynamic of the lecture hall. Okay. Although noting the stock objection to lectures is dead weight, and administrators might mean that more than others, more quickly conveyed in a book. Today we might argue for an asynchronous or recorded version, just get that content online, save it, and so on. Martina raised some questions about that. Jaspers rearticulates Nietzsche's emphasis on the student as hearing lectures, just where, this is Jaspers, the memory of outstanding scholars accompanies one throughout life. Indeed, such exemplars inspired Jaspers, as their teachers also inspired Heidegger and Nietzsche. As Jaspers writes on this aura that surrounds the teacher, echoing Nietzsche's reference to the Acroamatic, through his tone, his gestures, the real presence of his thinking, the lecturer can unconsciously convey, he doesn't really know how he's doing it, the feel of the subject. No doubt this can only be conveyed by the spoken word and only in a lecture, not in conversation or discussion. So Dirk Johnson pointed out that there would be Vorlesung and there would be Seminar, and Seminar are really kind of test runs so that you can give lectures of your own more than anything else. So it's not the same. For Jaspers, the focus is this lecture situation. That, there should be an S there, evokes something from the teacher which would remain hidden without it. There's nothing artificial about his thinking, his seriousness, his questioning, his perplexity. He allows us to take part in his innermost intellectual being. For Jaspers, this is lost the minute it becomes contrived. For Ivan Illich, it's lost the moment it's institutionalized. For us today, it's lost in any recording whenever the spoken teaching is inscribed, repeatable, and as dead as any written letter. Thank you for your attention.